It said that change is the only constant. And that is definitely the picture that emerges from futurist Parag Khanna's new book. It's called Move, The Forces Uprooting Us. And it is a geography of the coming decades that most certainly focuses the mind. Parag Khanna is founder and managing partner of the data and strategic advisory firm FutureMap. And he joins us now 13 hours ahead of us in Singapore for more. Parag, it's great to have you on the program again. How are you doing?
I'm doing very well. It's so nice to see you again, Steve.
Pleasure is ours. Let me just read an excerpt of the book to get us started here. Sheldon, if you would, let's bring this up and everybody can read along with. Mass migrations are inevitable, you write, and more than ever, they are necessary. In the coming decades, entire overpopulated regions of the world might be abandoned, while some depopulated territories may gain massively in population and become new civilizational centers. If you are lucky enough to be someplace from which you do not have to migrate, such as Canada or Russia, then chances are that migrants are coming your way. To paraphrase Lenin, you may not be interested in migration, but migration is interested in you. Very nicely said. Move, you have written amid a pandemic with very little movement. It's interesting. What makes you so confident that this migration that you're anticipating is actually going to happen?
Well, Steve, because it has been happening. In fact, we've been migrating, we've been moving, we've been nomadic for more than 100,000 years. When we think of ourselves as a sedentary people, it's really in the last couple of hundred years that we've become an industrial and sedentary civilization. But more importantly, over the last couple of centuries, really, the forces that compel us to move have been accumulating. First of all, you have to look at demographic issues. The labor imbalances and labor shortages, the gap between young and old in our countries and globally. That's very often been something that pulls hundreds of millions of people to countries that have those shortages. Well, we have them right now in a very extreme way. Then, of course, there's economic crises, there's conflicts, genocides, expulsions, civil wars, and of course, there's technology. Where a factory is closed because of automation, people move away. Where remote work is possible, people move to places they might enjoy that are lower cost and they can work remotely. And then there's climate change. So if you take every one of these factors, whether it's demographic, political, economic, technological, or climatological, every one of those forces, Steve, is in overdrive right now. So why do I think we're going to have more mass migration? Well, we've been heading in that direction cumulatively for centuries, and it's all going to continue after this pandemic.
Okay, that was my follow-up. You don't think COVID-19 is going to affect what has been transpiring for all those thousands of years, despite the fact that our lives have been remarkably disrupted over the last year and a half?
Well, we've had pandemics before. We've had the Black Death, we've had plagues and so forth. And of course, again, new patterns of behavior, new patterns of mobility emerge. And we're already experiencing those patterns. There's a couple of things we have to remember, Steve. It is neat and tidy to characterize the last 2 years as a total lockdown in which no humans being moved. That's not true. What actually happened is that, in fact, many people moved. Many people moved back to where they came from, for example. And in my story, in this book, it's not just about moving away from where you came from. It's movement in whatever direction for whatever reason. And it's the story of how we're always adjusting to new realities. So, for example, millions of South Asian guest workers from India and Pakistan moved during the pandemic. They went from the UAE and Saudi Arabia back home. If you're from New Zealand, Steve, you're still waiting online in a queue to get back home because you want to go back to New Zealand, but they only have a limited number of quarantine hotel rooms available on any given day. So people are moving all the time. Americans have been moving in record numbers during the so-called lockdown because of remote work. So in fact, underneath this surface, we have plenty of dynamism and agitation going on. And of course, the pandemic says nothing about climate change, which of course is in this century the biggest driver of mass migrations. And of course, the fact that we had a temporary lockdown and the skies cleared over some polluted countries for a couple of weeks has not really changed where we're going on climate change. And that's not a pretty picture.
Mm-hmm. You just gave us a long list of reasons why people move to different places around the world. You moved to Singapore. Is the reason you moved to Singapore on that list that you just gave us?
Well, the thing is that we're always looking for the right mix of factors and virtues and attributes, and very few places are perfect. So you can move to a place like Singapore because it's a very safe country, a very good government, a great place for professionals and families, a hyper-connected place as well, and in the heart of Asia. But you wouldn't necessarily move here because it's the most climatologically propitious place. We live on the equator. They're rising sea levels. But, you know, for the time being, perhaps for a good long time, it's a great place to be. I certainly consider it that. I could have lived anywhere in the world and I chose to be here. But that said, you know, we're looking for these pockets. You know, my view is that we're all in search of the right mix of what I call latitude, altitude, and attitude. Right? So the right geographical conditions, the right meteorological conditions, and certainly the right policies that suit our preferences. And again, it's not that one place is always going to meet the test. When I started writing this story, I thought it would be a much more linear kind of narrative. People will move from region X to region Y. What I realized in the end, over the course of all the research, is that actually we're going to keep on moving. It's not about one move. It's about mobility and response to disruptions that are coming all the time. It could be a pandemic. It could be a war. It could be an economic crisis. All of those things contribute to people moving. So we have to be mobile and be prepared to be more mobile.
Well, believe it or not, one of the reasons we have repeatedly asked you to come back on this program has nothing to do with the fact that you're always very bullish on Canada. You happen to be bullish on Canada, and in fact, here's you in the Globe and Mail saying the Canadian dream is reliable. Both today and tomorrow, a burdened 21st century Canadian should bear with pride. Can you elaborate on what you like about Canada and why you think it's such a terrific destination?
Sure, and I guess you could consider me an objective voice because I'm not Canadian. Mm-hmm. I've only been to Canada certainly less than 10 times in my entire life. So, you know, I take an analytical approach to these issues. Obviously, again, let's think latitude, altitude, and attitude, right? Canada does tick a lot of those boxes, certainly on the latitude and again, the other virtues as well. And, you know, you've just come out of an election where the fact that you are a mass migration country, a country that is taking in 400,000 new migrants every single year, a far higher proportion annually of your own population, about 1%, than any other country in the world is doing. And you're doing so voluntarily as a matter of strategic economic policy and without a major backlash is quite unique. So I consider Canada an absolute role model, not just some kind of fanciful future dream, but a place that's getting it right now. So I hold up Canada in this way, which again, I think is an objective characterization. So for those who are lucky enough to move to Canada, despite what I just said earlier, that could be a one-way ticket. It could be that the hundreds of thousands of people who are moving to Canada every single year may choose never to leave Canada. There may not be a better place in the 21st century, and I honestly believe that.
I wonder if you have a thought, and I hear this frequently, particularly from people who are from outside Canada, who are always wondering, where are the riots in your streets from people protesting against the kind of immigration you just described? And the fact is, yes, there are some people in the country, obviously, who are opposed to these high levels of immigration, but relatively few, considering how potentially controversial this issue could be. Do you have a sense about why we don't seem to be rioting in the streets over this issue?
Well, let me first make a general statement about Western societies, which is that we give far too much attention to those minority voices that are the radical xenophobes and populists and nationalists. Let's remember that their ideology and that their program and agenda for government always fails. So you can just watch them flame out as they have done. In Italy, for example, the far right in Germany is much the same. It's happening in Eastern Europe now also. Because ultimately, the forces of supply and demand in demographics always prevail. Countries realize that they actually need young people, that they need to engage in this war for young talent. And Canada, again, is doing that proactively, as I said before, as a matter of economic strategy. How will you diversify your economy? How will you grow in the services sector. How will you take advantage of your natural resource endowment as well, your booming agriculture? All of the things that Canada wants to do in terms of its economic policy do require more people. Services economies are about people working for other people. Yes, they're also about digitization, which also requires importing more IT experts and professionals. So any way you slice it, you need more people. And I think that Canada has just had this very successful communications effort around this, really, of course, going back to the 1970s or even earlier as you embrace multiculturalism. So, you know, we often use this term public education around civic issues as a cliche, you know, but it isn't. It's something that actually takes a generation to nurture. And fortunately, you've already done that. It's not impossible for other countries, but you can see how even places like the United Kingdom that have historically been enriched by migration and have been immigrant societies and magnets, you know, when you don't cultivate that public awareness about the benefits, you can have severe backsliding. And that's very self-destructive, as we've seen in the aftermath of Brexit and now during the pandemic with their shortages of medical workers, truck drivers, just about everything. So I'd like to think that for better or worse, some of our peers in Western societies are the poster children for how not to do this. And Canada is a great example of how to do it.
Understood. You use a term in the book, peak humanity. Let's get into that. What do you mean by that?
Well, this is a truly unique moment indeed in human history. And again, maybe that's a term that gets used very often, but I assure you that after the following, people will be convinced. If you recall the 20th century, the world population literally quadrupled in a less than 100-year period, right? From 1920 to the year 2000, the world population went from 2 billion people to 8 billion people. But today, Steve, we are living through an absolute plateau, a fertility crash that actually began in the 1970s and has been accelerated due to the global financial crisis, in which there was so much economic insecurity that older millennials and younger Gen Z stopped having children or deferred having children or had fewer children. And now the baby bust that we're living through right now due to the pandemic, which is far more severe than the baby bust of the global financial crisis. So two massive baby busts within a 12-year period mean that Generation Alpha, we're today's babies, today's toddlers, not yet fully born, right? Generation Alpha will continue until about 2025. So you and I can convene in 2026, and here's what we're going to know. That Generation Alpha actually was smaller than Generation Z. So today's fully formed Generation Z is the largest cohort, the largest demographic cohort that the human species will ever have produced. And it goes rapidly downhill from here because of the fertility crash. So we are literally at peak humanity. In the 1990s, Steve, you surely remember demographers forecasted the world population that would rise to 15 billion people. And here and now, I will tell you, Steve, the world population will probably not even reach 9 billion people, max 9.5 billion people. So it's still a lot. And some would say, well, this is good news for the planet and for climate change. And it could very well be some kind of automatic or subconscious self-preservation mechanism, you know, that's underway here, in which we, you know, sort of gradually reduce the total world population from that abnormal spike of the 20th century. But we need to engineer a glide path demographically where we don't just crash our population and our children stop having children, but rather that, again, through female empowerment and other means, you know, we control the world population, we bring it into a controlled descent, and we do so sustainably from an environmental standpoint. But yes, this is not only a new demographic reality, it's a new psychological situation, because instead of viewing the world as some, you know, overpopulated mass, rather we have to realize that we need to preserve those human beings that are alive. And we need to redistribute them in ways that are beneficial to all of our populations and societies, which is a very different way of looking at humanity and looking at our numbers than what we think of in our day-to-day discourse, which is, again, poisoned by xenophobia.
Well, let me do a follow-up on that, because among the 9 billion people, if we get there, that you reference, it's possible 4 billion of them will be so-called restless youth. And I think much of what we've heard about that category of 4 billion is that they aren't going to have as as good lives, as prosperous lives as their parents, and that they are in some respects a ticking time bomb. Many of them have no prospects for work at all. Others are not going to do as well as their folks, as I say. Are you more optimistic or more pessimistic about the potential of that $4
billion? Well, it really depends on the where, right? Where do they wind up? And here's the interesting thing about today's youth, those 4 billion people. First of all, it's important to point out that even though we talk about the world aging, more than half the world population is still young, if you will, you know, sort of millennials, Gen Z, Gen Alpha, and so forth. So we need to focus on youth. They are literally the future. Secondly, what that reminds us when we analyze sociologically the world's youth, it's a reminder that if there is a median or a normal or average human being, it's not a husband-wife couple and a two-income household with two kids living in a suburbia, right? The median human being in the world is young, is economically struggling, lives in a city, and has no children, right? That's what a normal, you know, sort of person, if you will, you know, looks like in the world today. And those are the people I'm most concerned about because, again, that's the vital demographic force of our future. So how many of them can relocate from the economically deprived and climate-stressed regions that they live in today to places where they can be productive and actually help to buttress our future civilization and our societies and fill our labor shortages? So I can imagine a win-win scenario where we redistribute global youth to habitable geographies and turn them into productive labor and taxpayers and homeowners and all of those things. But I can also imagine a scenario where those youth remain trapped where they are. And that would be devastating for us and also for them.
Let me pick up on that word habitable, and we'll finish up on this, which is particularly timely given that COP26 is happening in Scotland right now, and a huge chunk of your book has to do with the impact climate change is going to have on various geographical regions in this world. Can you take us through how you imagine the next quarter century unfolding in terms of the physical changes this planet will experience because of climate change?
Well, we have to prepare for the worst because, you know, the promises made in terms of climate mitigation at COP26 and its precursor summits are, to a large degree, too little too late. And I think we know that when we see the data, the atmospheric data, that really betrays the notion that we're making radical, you know, advancements in our climate mitigation investments. So I advocate focusing much more on climate adaptation, which is to say, again, how do we invest in resilient infrastructure, mobile infrastructure, seawalls and barriers, relocating, obviously, lots of people, on hydroponic agriculture? All of these sorts of things represent investments in adaptation, and we need to invest a lot more in that. Right now, adaptation only gets about 6% of climate-related investments, which is itself not enough. And so along the way, over the next quarter century, as you suggested, we're going to continue to see very radical changes in our topography in the world and in our climate, in our atmosphere, and we have to adjust to it. Please remember, Steve, that even if we were to cease all emissions today, even if we were to undertake radical geoengineering measures, the climate is a complex system. It doesn't snap back and suddenly appear to be what it was in 1800 or 1900 or 2000. It's going to evolve in new directions. The places that have been completely obliterated by drought are not suddenly going to experience massive rainfall starting tomorrow. We need to either move technologies to those people where they need them, or move those people to places where there are resources. And that, to me, is the simple, you know, two-step formula, if you will, to preserving our humanity amidst the radical changes that our climate is experiencing thanks to us, unfortunately.
And just finally, what is the one region of the world that you think will feel the impact of all of what you've just described most immediately?
Well, it's going to be South Asia, which is, again, a really perverse irony because it's the most populated region of the entire world. India alone now has about the same number of people as China. If you add in Pakistan and Bangladesh, that's obviously far, far more. So you're talking about roughly 1.8 billion people who live in severely climate-stressed subcontinent, whether it is droughts, floods, desertification, and other factors. So I worry a lot in particular about the South Asian population broadly. So I focus a lot on them and their future movements to North America, to Europe, and also northward into Central Asia and Russia.
Are there ever days where you just don't want to get out of bed? I mean, this is a very frightening future that you are painting a picture of, potentially.
Well, I mean, I've also voted with my feet, so for now I find myself in a very secure place. But who knows, maybe one day I'll be your neighbor.
Well, you do like Canada, so if that happens, I look forward to it because I always enjoy our conversations. Parag, thanks so much for coming onto the agenda tonight. The name of the book, once again, is Move, and we are delighted that it has brought Parag Khanna back to our airwaves tonight from Singapore. You be well, and thanks so much for joining us.
Thank you. Always such a pleasure.
The Agenda with Steve Paikin is made possible through generous philanthropic contributions from viewers like you. Thank you for supporting TVO's journalism.